come to you this morning, we pray that you would be with us, that you would open our hearts and our minds to you. In your Son's name, amen. You know those family newsletters that we all get at Christmas? The one or two page descriptions of what's been happening in the Smith family or the Jones family during the year? In my experience, this one is pretty typical. The Smith family wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy, Healthy New Year. John received a big promotion this year at FutureBright, an amazing company. Stock options vested with more to come. Marcy is getting ready for graduate school. David is now in the sixth grade, but is taking algebra at the high school. He's doing quite well, and the high schoolers love him. He continues to be a terrific little league pitcher, and just recently took up golf. Endicott is now in kindergarten. He loves to read and write, and is making lots of friends. Have you ever noticed how absolutely wonderful these letters make other people's families' lives seem and sound? Wouldn't it be refreshing to get a letter like this? The Jones family wishes you the best. We've certainly had our ups and downs this year, and all I can say is thank God for Zoloff. I'm happy to report that Bob's affair is finally over. Unfortunately, he just lost his job with Low-Tech. Still, if Bob can finally hit it big with one of his 100 or so weekly lottery tickets, we'll be okay. Tim is finished with rehab. He's even talking about going back to school, although that might have to wait. It all depends upon what happens when he goes to court next month. Jeannie had some trouble in college this year. She's on academic probation and is thinking of dropping out. She says she wants to find herself. We're excited, however, about her newest relationship. It's been 3 weeks now. We're crossing our fingers that maybe this is the one. He's really nice and says he is close to being divorced. And little Danny isn't so little anymore. He's the biggest child in the first grade. His teacher says Danny likes to hit the other kids. Sometimes he bites. Recently, there was a knife incident. Danny brought a knife to school. It was just a butter knife, not sure the 3-day suspension was necessary. On a sad note, we had to put Puddles to sleep. They say you don't get attached to hamsters, but take my word for it, you do. We may fantasize, but we'll probably never receive such an honest, tell it like it really is Christmas letter. But wait a minute, there actually is at least one oral family history written down years ago that does tell it like it is. In Genesis, the family stories of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are tell-it-like-it-is stories. It makes it clear that the mothers and fathers of the faith were real people, imperfect people, like me and you. The most famous family tree in the Bible, the one started by Adam and Eve, suffered from a serious case of moral blight. Eve overindulged. Adam played the blame game. Cain murdered his little brother. Noah drank too much. Abraham lied. Sarah insisted that her husband play favorites. This began a disastrous pattern of favoritism that was then passed on from generation to generation. Rebekah favored Jacob. Isaac favored Esau. So Jacob and Rebekah cheated Esau by tricking Isaac. Jacob then sired a gang of hoodlums. We saw some of them up here today. One of whom was his favorite. Genesis is a relative disaster. disaster. Sibling rivalry has been with us from the beginning and still seriously impacts family life today. Julia, first grader, comes home and proudly reports to Dad that she is now officially a Brownie. Not to be outdone, her three-year-old brother Christopher rushes up to Dad and proudly announces, "I'm a cupcake." Joseph, as we heard in the song sung during the offering, was set up by the behavior of his father, Jacob. His father, Jacob, destined Joseph to be in disastrous relationship with those brothers. Joseph's brothers were out of line, but Jacob was out of touch. The consequences of Jacob's relational ineptness was family disunity, rivalry, and contention. Their family mess culminates in our scripture passage for this morning when Jacob says to his 17-year-old favored son, Joseph, "Go now, see if it is well with your brothers and with the flock, and bring word back to me." So Joseph went after his brothers and found them in Dothan. They saw him at a distance, and before he came near to them, they conspired to kill him. So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the long robe with sleeves that he wore, and they took him and threw him into a pit. Then they sat down to eat, and looking up, they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead on their way to Egypt. Judah then said to his brothers, "What profit is it if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him, for he is our brother, our own flesh." And his brothers agreed. They drew Joseph up, lifting him out of the pit, and sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. The brothers didn't know, but needed to know, that they were loved and valued by their father. Jacob needed a wake-up call, and Joseph, in the midst of that family, needed a protector. But Joseph isn't protected. Instead, he becomes the family scapegoat, ending up way down in Egypt land, a distant and dark place. Once in Egypt, Joseph chose to bury, not face, his painful past. He concentrated on the here and now. He made a new life for himself, becoming all that he could be, eventually rising to the position of prime minister of Egypt. As prime minister, Joseph could have traveled anywhere he wanted. He chose not to return to Canaan. He knew where to find his family, but he didn't contact them. He keeps his hurt-filled family secrets a secret. He keeps them untouched and untreated. He is content to leave the past in the past. When hurt runs deep, distance and time are often required before healing and reconciliation can take place. But unlike Joseph, God is not content to leave our hurting, wounded hearts untreated. Restoration matters to God, and our healing requires confronting the hurt. So eventually, in God's perfect timing, not in Joseph, God shook things up. You have all heard the idiom, "If Muhammad won't come to the mount, the mountain won't come to Muhammad, Muhammad must go to the mountain." Well, Joseph won't go to his brothers, so God brings the brothers to Joseph. We read in Genesis 41:57, "All countries came to Joseph in Egypt to buy grain, because the famine was severe in all the lands. When Joseph's brothers do come, I personally can imagine that while selling the grain to people from all over the Middle East, Joseph hears his brothers before he sees them. It's not just the Hebrew language he hears, but the dialect of his home. Joseph, hearing, turns and looks, and there they stand, all 10 of them. But the brothers don't recognize Joseph. To not tip his hand, Joseph speaks through an interpreter. The brothers speak to him with their eyes and gestures. They motion for the brother carrying the money to come forward and to spill the coins on the table. When Joseph sees the silver, his lip curls, his stomach turns. He may have named his firstborn son Manasseh, which means God made me forget. But the money makes him remember. The last time that he saw coins in the hands of these sons of Jacob, his brothers, they were laughing while he was sobbing in terror. The brothers fall face first into the dirt, fulfilling one of Joseph's childhood dreams. Joseph then interrogates them, asking, "Where do you come from?" "From the land of Canaan to buy food," they respond. "No," he challenges them. "You are spies. You have come to see the nakedness of the land." They say to him, "No, my lord, your servants have come to buy food. We are all sons of one man. We are honest men. Your servants have never been spies." But Joseph says to them, "No, you have come to see the nakedness of the land." They explain further, "Well, we, your servants, are 12 brothers, the sons of a certain man in the land of Canaan. The youngest, however, is now with our father, and one is no more." Joseph gasps. This is the first family news he has heard in 20 years. His father is alive. His younger brother, Benjamin, who he adores, is alive. And the whole family thinks he's dead. Joseph snaps at them, saying, "To prove you are telling the truth, I'll let one of you go back and get your younger brother and bring him here. The rest of you can stay here in jail." With that, Joseph has his brother's hands bound and marched off to prison. The tables have turned. The brothers threw Joseph into a pit, ignoring his cries for help. Now Joseph ignores their pleas and throws them into jail. Embittered by victimization, revenge feels sweet. The problem is that, as Mahatma Gandhi once said, an eye for an eye only makes the whole world blind. Two restaurant owners are bitter rivals. Their restaurants are located directly across the street from each other. Every day they watch to see how many people go into the other person's restaurant. If one restaurant ends up with more patrons on any one particular day, the owner of that restaurant feels really good. One night in a dream, an angel appears to one of the owners and says, "I will give you anything you ask, but whatever it is, your rival will receive twice as much. If you want to be rich, I can make you rich, but your rival will be twice as rich. If you want, I can give you a long life, but your rival will have a longer life. What is your desire?" The man frowns, thinks for a moment, and then says, "This is what I want. Strike me blind in one eye." Not just an eye for an eye, but two eyes. Vengeance is a double-edged sword. After 3 days, God softens Joseph's heart. He has his brothers released from prison and brought to him. He still, however, plays the tough guy, with a less punitive, less vengeful plan. "Go on back," he says, "but I want to see this younger brother you talk about. I'll keep one of you here in Egypt to guarantee that you return with him." The brothers agree, and then right in front of Joseph, who they don't know speaks Hebrew, they rehearse the day that they sold Joseph into slavery. They say to one another, "We are truly guilty concerning our brother, for we saw the anguish of his soul when he pleaded with us, and we would not hear. Therefore, his distress has come upon us." When Joseph hears these words, he is moved, his eyes filled with tears. He steps into the shadow and weeps. Why is he crying? He cries because he overhears good news. He learns that his brothers haven't forgotten all about him. They feel badly, guilty for what they did to him. Perhaps, therefore, there's a chance for reconciliation, for wholeness after all. There is a glimmer of hope. Listed on the screens are words and phrases that characterize some of the hardships and dysfunction evident in Joseph's family. Have any of these issues marked your family? Abandonment, troubled marriages, premature death, hatred, sibling rivalry, favoritism, severe grief, disregard for others, parental neglect, guilt, deception, betrayal, infertility, resentment, abuse, extramarital affairs, harsh treatment, brokenness, self-absorption, secrecy. Coming face to face with old hurts can be disorientating. When Joseph encounters his brothers for the first time in years, he withholds his identity from them, speaks harshly, makes false accusations, jails them, releases them, puts conditions on their departure and conditions on their returns, holds one of them hostage, and conceals his powerful emotions. He is all over the place. I'm wondering, when you think about the hurts that you have experienced in your life, do conflicting thoughts and emotions surface for you? They do for me. Joseph's path to reconciliation was with his family, was a long and difficult and highly emotional thing. The first thing that he needed was time and space away from family dynamics to become the person God had created and gifted him to be. Only after his human potential is realized and he is living out of the life that God created him to live is he strong enough to confront the pain, to confront those who hurt him. That initial confrontation happens when the brothers come to buy grain. It is not Joseph's timing, it is God's timing. But Joseph is not reconciled with his family at that point. There is more that needs to happen, important spiritual lessons to understand. But I get ahead of myself. Reconciliation is actually next week's topic. Today, we're simply talking about the hurt, the conflict. When I was a young minister in Pasadena, one of my favorite songs was "We Are the Family of God."
We are the family of God. Yes, we are the family of God.
experience deep hurt in relationship with their human families. Some of the deepest hurts that people experience in their spiritual life come from misunderstandings or experiences within the family of God. And just like God wants the hurts experienced in relationship with our earthly families and with our friends to be healed, God wants the hurts we experience in interacting with the family of God to be healed. We don't need to let our spiritual wounds from the church fester. Go away mad or suffer in silence. Instead, we can lay our spiritual wounds before God in prayer. When we do, we may be surprised, like Joseph, to see how God directs us to health and wholeness. As I've already said, when Joseph sees his flesh and blood for the first time in 20 years, a mixture of hurt, hate, love surges inside of him, and he doesn't know exactly what to do. Maybe you don't know what to do with those who have hurt you either. I hope that your childhood was a happy time, when your parents kept everyone safe, fed, and smiling. I hope your dad came home every day, that your mom tucked you into bed and said prayers with you, that your siblings were your best friends. But even in the best of families, with the best of intentions, things happen. Hurt happens. Perhaps your early years were hard ones. For some reason, the people who should have cared for you didn't or couldn't. Perhaps you, like Joseph, made the best of it. You made a life for yourself. Perhaps you even started your own family. You've been happy to leave Canaan with all of its pain in your rear view mirror. But God isn't. God wants not only your whole heart, God wants your heart's healed. Why? Why is healing our hearts, making us whole, important to God? It is important to God because hurt people. Think about it. Why do we fly off the handle, avoid conflict, or seek to please everyone? Might these tendencies of ours have something to do with some unhealed hurt? God wants to help heal those hurts for our sake and for the sake of others, especially future generations. We don't have to pass on to others the hurt bequeathed to us in interaction with family, friends, co-workers, bosses, our world. Instead, we can talk to God, invite God to reimagine the past with us, bringing the pain out into the open. By throwing his brothers into prison, Joseph re-envisions the past. By doing so, he discovers the divinely ordained pathway to transformational healing in his life. Discovering the pathway is the first step. Then Joseph, step by step in the next 8 chapters, he is open and God heals the hurt. Next week we will see exactly how that happened for Joseph and how it can happen for us. For now, just know and trust the transformational healing can take place. It may take a long time. It may take a lifetime. But it is worth the effort. Family pain is often the deepest pain that we experience, because family members are supposed to be trustworthy, and they're the ones wounds that inflicted the pain. The good news of the gospel is that our heavenly family, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, have not betrayed us, but have taken our pain upon themselves. On the cross, Jesus betrays the betrayal. You are God's beloved child, God's creation, knit together in your mother's womb, destined for heaven. You are a part of God's eternal family. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit love you unconditionally. Will you let them set you on the path to reconciliation? No quick fixes. Faith is a journey. Still, the journey to wholeness begins with one single step. Will you take it? If you need help talking to God about your pain, any one of the pastors of this church, the counselors, spiritual directors, or Stephen ministers of our church would be happy to walk along with you as a friend in Christ. Happy to walk with you because this is